Sarkar sir to introduce Dr. Rajiv Parekh. A big hand for our sponsor, Bayer. Our chairperson, Dr. S.K. Poddar. And our speaker, Dr. Rajiv Parekh.
Thank you, Dr. Sohan. So we have, more than 50 CMEs, more than that, in our group on coronary artery disease, but on peripheral vascular disease, I think this is the first CME in our group. And we are very fortunate to have Dr. Rajiv Parekh as a speaker. He is pioneer in peripheral vascular surgery in the city of Delhi. He was in Gangaram Hospital. He established the Department of Vascular Surgery there in 1991. And at present, he is the chairman of the Department of Vascular Surgery at Medanta MedCity Hospital, Gurgaon, and he also comes to defense college. He is a graduate of Maulana Azhar Medical College, where then he did MS from the same college in 1986, and then he did FRCS from England, and he also was trained in vascular surgery in England. He started first independent department of vascular surgery at Gangaram Hospital in 1991, and he was also national convener for D&D course of vascular surgery in India. At present, he is chairman of vascular surgery department, Medanta Hospital, and also vice president of International Society of Vascular Surgery, USA. So we all know peripheral vascular disease is increasing day by day as coronary artery disease. And peripheral vascular disease is mostly undiagnosed, and I think in most of the coronary artery disease, if we try to diagnose peripheral artery disease, maybe 50% of the patients will have peripheral artery disease also. So now I request Dr. Rajiv Parekh to start it now. And I think we will be benefited by
being resident of Delhi. In fact, my family goes back, believe it or not, 900 years in Delhi.
Wow.
I have history and books to prove it. We still have our own ancestral house in the depths of Chandni Chowk, and one of those five lanes in the depths of the city. So, despite the fact of being from Delhi, and schooling, St. Columbus School, Maulana Azad Medical College, MBBS, MS, everything.
Can you keep it? Sorry.
Okay. Maulana Azad Medical College, both.
And then coming back and then joining Gangaram Hospital, where I was for 21 years. And now, of course, I'm at the Medanta MediCity Hospital in Gurgaon. And I also come to the Defense Colony clinic that we have here on the main ring road. Some of you may have seen it coming away in and out. So it's the Medanta Medical Clinic. The reason why I'm telling you this is the fact that I am I've been ignorant that such a vibrant group exists, and you people have been meeting here and say thanks. Thank you very much for introducing me to this group, and I'm sure we'll have many more interactions in future. So thank you very much, Dr. Sushil and Dr. Poddar, for giving me this opportunity to come and talk to you this evening. Yes, there was that little interaction I had with Dr. Sujit, and I said, I've never been here. I don't know what will be the audience, and what would they want to listen to, and vascular surgery is a very, very wide subject. So he told me that something which is uncommonly seen on earth, something which would be of interest to clinicians, and something which is usually either missed or misdiagnosed. So that was his diktat to me, and I thought that, okay, I'm going to try and talk about vascular surgery in its entirety. I'm just going to give you a bird's eye view of what we do. Most of you have heard of cardiothoracic vascular surgery. CTVS is something that we all know of. We've all grown up with it. I was at the Maulana Azad Medical College, and for all those 10 years that I was there, it was the CTVS department of the GB Hospital, which used to, as you all remember, there was no vascular surgery. In fact, unfortunately, even till date, there is no department, believe it or not, there is no department of vascular surgery in any of the teaching hospitals in Delhi, including the Orient Institute of Medical Sciences. There is no department of vascular surgery there. It's all still a part of of CTVS, cardiothoracic vascular surgery. So now I'm going to try and show you what we do as vascular surgeons, and I'm going to take you through a slightly different route, in the sense I'll try and, as Dr. Sheila also very correctly pointed out, India is going to be the diabetes capital of India and of the world, and there are going to be a huge number of patients suffering from the complications of diabetes, which are the peripheral vascular complications of diabetes. We all know about coronary artery disease, the cerebrovascular disease, so strokes, heart attacks, and kidney failures, and ophthalmology, I mean the retinopathy, which is the usual complication that one hears of. But there is one complication of diabetes which is probably one of the most lethal complications of diabetes, and that is the peripheral vascular disease complications of diabetes. There was a study which was published in the New England Journal of Medicine about 7 or 8 years ago, which says that 45% of patients who undergo an amputation because of a diabetic foot infection. So anybody who has a diabetic foot infection and undergoes an amputation, 45% of these patients will be dead in 5 years. What I'm going to try and bring together in a nutshell. Now, this is something that I thought would be of interest. You know, general surgery was the mother of all the surgical disciplines, as you know. So 50, 60, 70 years ago, it was only general surgery. So a general surgeon, I'm sure a few of you may have, maybe a lot of you would have heard Dr. K.C. Mahajan. Dr. K.C. Mahajan, Delhi nursing home, famous surgeon, probably one of the most famous surgeons of North India in his times, fortunately no more. But he was a general surgeon. I have seen him as a child. I've known him because my father and Dr. K.C. Mahajan went to Lahore Medical College together. This is way back in 1942. So I've sort of, you know, literally, I've seen him ever since I was born, and we've been very, very close families together. So I have seen Dr. K.C. Mahajan, who was an FRCS general surgeon from England. I have seen him do tonsillectomy. I have seen him do neurosurgery. I have seen him do a closed mitral valvotomy. I have seen him do a thoracotomy. I have seen him do gallbladders, appendicectomies, and all bowel resections. I have seen him do colonic cancers. I have seen him do vaginal hysterectomies. I have seen him do hysterectomies as well. I have seen him do orthopedic implants. I have seen him put in plasters and repair tendons. So that was the range of general surgery that used to be in his era. This is 1945 and 1950s. But obviously, just like everything else, evolution, and this is how it evolves. Orthopedics separated as a branch from general surgery, orthopedicians came into view. GI surgery, colorectal surgery, hepatobiliary surgery, urology, pediatric surgery, and the only one which remained together for a very, very long time is cardiothoracic surgery. Unfortunately, cardiothoracic and vascular surgery, it still remains one specialty in most of the teaching hospitals in India. But now, fortunately, there are a lot of hospitals, especially I think most of the private hospitals, have taken it upon themselves to try and create separate divisions of cardiac surgery, thoracic surgery, and vascular surgery, and that is the reason. Now, why and how is that going to happen? So, I'm just going to give you a little brief background on this. Right compression. All this is primarily coronary artery surgery. So, it's coronary artery surgery and heart valve replacement surgery and stuff. But the only vascular procedures mentioned in this cardiothoracic vascular surgery is resection of thoracic and thoracoabdominal aneurysms and repair of thoracic aortic aneurysms. There is no mention of any major peripheral vascular surgical procedures which needs to be taught to these trainees. So can you imagine somebody who's gone through an MCS program in CTVS surgery, how is he ever going to be able to manage the peripheral vascular procedures? So the operative experience which is required to pass the exam, the MCH exam, is that in a 3-year MCH course, 200 cardiac operations should have been performed or assisted by them. 50 of them should be thoracic operations, and only 50 vascular operations per year is the requirement for a graduate, postgraduate who needs to become, or who's going to become an MCH in cardiac thoracic surgery. Now you can imagine, what is he going to learn in those 50 cases because of what I'm going to tell you now. So, this is what we see, I'm sure. Unfortunately, this is not something you would like to see before your dinner, but this is the kind of patients that we see. I'm sure most of you have seen this in your clinical practice, especially with patients with diabetes, peripheral ganglia. Then you can see toes, I mean have fingers, hand ganglia. Then you can see patients with swelling in their back of the knee, popliteal aneurysm. The artery becomes enlarged and it becomes an aneurysm. Then you can have a patient with a stroke. Now when a patient strokes, it usually is, most of the times, it is as a result of a narrowing in the carotid artery. And because of the narrowing of the carotid artery, small pieces of emboli go up into the brain, causing TIAs or transient ischemic attacks, as you all know. And that is what causes strokes. So that is because of a ruptured lobe in the carotid bifurcation. Now the treatment for that always has been since 1950 is a carotid endarterectomy, which means that you can actually open up this artery. See, that's the narrowing that you can see here. This is the artery which has been opened up under local anesthesia. Under local anesthesia, we can open up a carotid artery and remove the plaque. This is the plaque which is sitting inside here, which is that, and that is the final result. As you can see, the artery is completely opened up. And once the artery completely opens up, obviously there's going to be no chance of a stroke subsequently. So carotid endarterectomy is something which has been and is the gold standard for prevention of strokes. These days, for the last maybe about 15 odd years, 12 to 15 years, we have also been using carotid stents. You know, you can stent this artery just like a coronary artery or any others. You can stent these arteries for increasing the flow and prevention of strokes. But unfortunately, carotid stents is not without complications. As you can realize, is something that you're going to stretch, but the plaque still remains. The plaque has just been pushed out, but it is still within the sidewall of the carotid artery, and the chances of it fragmenting and coming through these stents and causing further TIAs always remains. So if possible, whenever possible, carotid endarterectomy or an open removal under local anesthesia is the treatment of choice if a person has a TIA or a stroke. So this is something that can be done if a person has a carotid. Now this is an aortic aneurysm. An aortic aneurysm, as you know, is something most of the time is completely asymptomatic. It has no symptoms till the patient suddenly drops dead because it has ruptured. Most of the times, aortic aneurysms have no symptoms. Usually, they just, sometimes you can actually, if they're very big, you can actually feel them pulsating in the stomach. In fact, I can never forget this 83-year-old gentleman who was a retired army officer who came and said, he says, "Doc sir, बहुत कमजोरी आ गई है, मैं अब तो बहुत कमजोर हो गया हूँ, मुझे लगता है मेरा हार्ट मेरे पेट में आ गया है." Because he used to put his hand on his stomach and his hand used to pulsate. That was not his heart in the stomach, it was an aortic aneurysm which he could feel pulsating. So he used to feel that his heart had slipped down into the abdomen, but that was the what it was. So very rarely you have patients coming and telling you about aortic aneurysms or being symptoms of aortic aneurysm, but this is something which happens, and I'll show you and I will give you some data on this. Again, in the New England Journal of Medicine, about 8 years ago, there was another article in which they said they followed up patients who had undergone coronary artery interventions, either stenting or a coronary artery bypass, a CABG. 10% of patients, 10 years after having a coronary intervention, develop aortic aneurysms. 10%. 10% of patients who are having a coronary stent and a coronary bypass today, I think in the city of Delhi, there must be at least about 40 to 50 patients, if not more, undergoing coronary artery stenting, and maybe about 35, 40, maybe 50 patients undergoing a coronary bypass every day. So you're talking about 100 patients every day undergoing coronary artery interventions. So 10 years from today, 10 of these patients will develop or can develop aortic aneurysm. That is the incidence of aortic aneurysm. And that you might turn around and say, I've never seen one. I don't think it happens. You're absolutely right. Why haven't you seen it? Because most of them have no symptoms. Unless you look for them, you won't find them. Unless you see them, they will be dead before you even realize that they've had it. And unfortunately, because we do not do post-mortem examinations for unexpected deaths or undiagnosed deaths, you never get to know that some of these patients do actually die of ruptured aortic aneurysms. So that is something that needs to be kept in mind. And I think we owe it to our patients, especially after coronary interventions, to make sure that they do not develop, or they do not have aneurysms which are developing in their body, which may or may not rupture at some stage. So that is something. So today, I'm going to try and tell you a little bit more about aortic aneurysms, but that is just to start off with. And then of course, this is again another very important part of the going back to our peripheral vascular interventions. This is again something that we see. A lot of patients today, unfortunately, develop chronic renal insufficiency, chronic renal disease, and most of these patients in the earlier days used to die waiting for kidney transplants. Today, 95% of patients are alive or kept alive by chronic maintenance hemodialysis. Very few people undergo, even today, very few people undergo kidney transplants. A lot of them do, but most of the patients are today alive only with renal hemodialysis, kidney replacement therapy. A lot of our patients, and one of the most famous ones that I know is Mr. I.K. Gujral, our ex-prime minister. He unfortunately died. He was on dialysis for 14 years. He lived for 14 years on dialysis. So this is something which, and there are lots and lots of people you won't even know. They come in the morning, have their dialysis done, and after that have a full life. They just walk around and do everything possible. So a lot of patients continue and live with effective coronary, effective hemodialysis. How is that done? That is through the creation of an AV fistula, and a fistula in the arm, which is used for the dialysis. Now, once this dialysis fistula is made, we, as clinicians, it's important for us to make sure that that fistula remains alive. That means it doesn't get narrowed and doesn't get blocked. Repeatedly puncturing these arteries for dialysis will actually cause them to narrow. And if they do get narrowed, the fistula will eventually get blocked. And that is what is actually happening here. You can see this is the fistula. That's the connection, that's the vein, that's the artery. That's the vein and that's the artery coming down. And here you can see that that's the fistula, which is okay, but you can develop, see, you can developing a narrowing here. You can see that there is a narrowing here. This must have been where the repeated puncturing is done, and that is why this fistula is now getting narrowed and will eventually block off. And once it blocks off, it cannot be reopened. So we have to make sure that this does not get blocked. And then, so what we do here is without an operation, we enter this vein either from here or from here in the arm through a needle, pass a wire through this, as you can see. Can you see this wire running? And with that wire, we do a ballooning of that area which is narrow. So it is done under local anesthesia in the operating theater. On these days, actually, we can even do it under ultrasound guidance. You do not even need an operating theater or your radiology or a fluoroscopy. You can actually open up these and do ballooning of this area, and you can see that the fistula can be salvaged and the fistula can run again, and the patient can then continue to have his dialysis. So this is again something that is required. Again, something that the peripheral vascular surgeon needs to do and be aware of. Again, this is something that adds to this entire gamut of practice. Of course, this is a patient who, increasingly we see these patients, this is a car seat belt injury. Car seat belt which runs across, the patient suddenly, is the driver or maybe a front passenger, and the car suddenly brakes. With the impact of the brake, there is a complete compression between the seat belt and the thoracic spine. And that's where the aorta runs across your chest like this, as you know, the heart, the aorta runs down like this, the seat belt runs across like this, and if the seat belt compresses the aorta against the thoracic spine at the back, it can rupture and it forms what is called a pseudoaneurysm. You can see this is the thoracic aorta and you can see it has ruptured, and this is a huge, and this again needs to be treated if it is picked up in time. So coming back to what we were talking about, peripheral vascular disease, what I showed you were examples of peripheral vascular disease, patients with diseases which need intervention, which needs doctors, which needs people to recognize them, which needs people to diagnose them, which needs people to treat them. And believe me, no cardiothoracic vascular surgeon can ever do this, because A, they are not trained for this, they've only done cardiac surgery. B, most of them are so busy doing coronary arteries and bypasses, there is no way. The paradigm that I've shown you, the number of cases that I've shown you, no cardiothoracic vascular surgeon, whether it's the All India Institute of Medical Sciences or in the GV Pant Hospital or anywhere for that matter, will ever be able to go through all this that is being done. So there is a void. There is a huge burden of peripheral vascular disease which has no stakeholders. There is no one who's actually looking after them. And that is where vascular surgeons come in. These are general surgeons. They are not cardiac surgeons. I am not a cardiac surgeon. I cannot do an open heart bypass. I'm not a CTVS, MCH, MCTVS surgery. I'm a general surgeon trained with MS General Surgery in Delhi at Maulana Azad, and then subsequently went for my vascular surgery training in England, and that is where I was not trained in cardiac surgery at all. And this is somewhere that you can do and look after all these peripheral vascular cases. So this is the reason why I was trying to, the reason why I was taking you through all this is to understand that peripheral vascular surgery and peripheral vascular science is a completely different department, it's a completely different division, and it is time that this department and division actually stands out on its own, and more general surgeons, if you have any, if your children or your brothers and sisters are still in training in their MBBS or MS days, I think this is a science or a specialty to get into. We do have a DNB program. I started one in Gangaram Hospital which still runs. I've started another one at the Vedanta Medicity Hospital. We take in 2 students every year. So between the 2 hospitals, there are 4 students every year, and we take them batches up to and try. It's a small number, but at least a step forward to try and treat the patients that we see. There are close to 3.8 million people who will be affected with vascular diseases all across the country. And believe me, there are not even, if you really look at them, not even 380 vascular surgeons in the whole country. Even today, there are very few dedicated vascular surgeons in the country. So there is a huge void in this specialty, and that is something that needs to be looked at. So I am now going to try and again take you through what we do presently. So what and who is a vascular specialist? He's basically a surgeon, needs to be a surgeon. He also needs to be an interventionalist, because today, a lot of our procedures that we do are done endovascularly or through needle holes, like a radiological procedure. So we puncture arteries, we pass in catheters, we do balloonings, we put in stents, and we open up these arteries. If there is an aneurysm, we cover it up with a covered stent, and I'll show you one of those as well. And those covered stents, that means it's basically a stent, a normal stent, which is just lined with a cloth, which is a PTFE material, which is polytetrafluoroethylene, PTFE, which is covered from outside. That's why it's called a covered stent. And this is placed in exactly the same position where the bleeding is occurring. So the bleeding stops. So that is why a covered stent is placed. So somebody who's an interventionalist can be a vascular specialist. And of course, he needs to be a physician, because most important is diagnosing vascular problems, and that for that you require the skill sets and the understanding of a physician. A physician is probably the most intelligent clinician, because he's the one who has the entire paradigm of medical, surgical and unrelated specialties, and of course also knows about the families and will be able to give the best diagnosis and solution to these patients. So they need to be a physician, and of course they also need to be a diabetic foot care specialist, because a lot of these patients will have foot wounds which would require treatment at some later stage. If you want maybe, you know, a few months later or whenever, we can talk about, specifically talk about diabetic foot complications and how to manage diabetic foot complications to avoid amputations, because that is something that happens. But anyway, that's at a later date. And of course, there's a lot of research work going on in our fields in which we actually start implanting stem cells into the blood vessel, into the muscles of the legs to prevent amputations if there is a complete occlusion of all the arteries. So there's a lot of stem cell work being done. We are actually involved in about 3 or 4 studies currently with very encouraging results, and that is something that can be done and should be done. So a vascular surgery center today needs to be basically equipped with a laboratory with non-invasive imaging, which means we should be able to do a color Doppler examination. We need to be able to pressure, you know, to check the blood pressure in all the 4 limbs. And of course, there should be a vascular surgery clinic in which there can be what is called a diabetic foot care center. That means we only look after, or somebody's, one person looks after all the diabetic wounds that are there. And this is something that can be done within the confines of one hospital or a clinic, wherever a person is working. There could be, of course, a minor operation theater for minor procedures, but the backbone of the investigations and the procedures is the hybrid operation theater, which means it's an operation theater with a cath lab in which we are able to do angiographies while we are operating during the surgeries, so that the procedures can be done and the patients can be given a good outcome. So that's a vascular surgery center, because essentially what has happened today is that surgery or surgical procedures has actually been transformed by endovascular procedures. A lot of our surgical procedures that I trained with in England are now being done endovascularly through needles, through punctures, through wires, through stents and balloons. So most of the surgical procedures are reducing, and non-invasive or minimally invasive procedures are actually overtaking them, and this is replacing most of the surgical procedures. And of course, the future today is robotics. We will be able to actually, we have a robotic, a Da Vinci robot at the Medanta Hospital, 3 of them, and we are actually going to, I think our future will be that we will probably be able to provide these services through the robotic route as well. So there is huge excitement in the vascular, endovascular interventions field. And these services can be, as I said, we repair aneurysms. You can see the first one out there. That's an aneurysm that has been repaired by placing a stent graft. Those are stents which has got a covered, the covering, which is the PTFE, which is placed inside the body without an operation. 2 small little puncture holes in the groin, and we can go in and push up this stent graft and then open this up and layer it inside so that the aneurysm is excluded. So as you can see here, if the aneurysm is where it is and the stent graft is above and below it, then the aneurysm is excluded from the flow and the blood then goes through these plastic tubes and the aneurysm is secured. And of course, this is what I was mentioning, is a covered stent. This is actually a stent with the covering on top, and this can be used if a patient is either bleeding or has an aneurysm. So now, we get on to the next one. Yes, that's right. Why are we talking about it?
Ruptured aortic aneurysm.
That's correct. He died of a ruptured aortic aneurysm. In 1964, he died of a ruptured aortic aneurysm. Unfortunately, there was no vascular surgeon at that time. The only vascular surgeon that they could talk about was Michael DeBakey, who was the pioneer vascular surgeon in the United States in Houston, and they contacted him. But the earliest that he could come, even if he got onto a plane right at that time and come here, it would have taken him more than 24 hours to arrive from Houston. The planes weren't as fast as they are today at that time in 1964, and it would have taken him 24 hours, and Panditji would have taken 4 minutes to die. So that's exactly what happened. He died of a ruptured aortic aneurysm. Unfortunately, there was no one at that time to save him and do anything about it. So that's the reason why we're talking about aortic aneurysm. It can be something which can affect someone with no symptoms, no warnings, it can just come suddenly out of the blue. So we have to have a very high index of suspicion in the high-risk groups. Who are the high-risk groups? Patients who are diabetics, patients who have high blood pressure, patients who have high cholesterol, patients who are smokers, patients who have history of coronary artery interventions, as I talked about. So these are the groups, which is something that we see every day. That's a bulk of our practices, isn't it? I mean, we are seeing diabetic smokers, chronic hypertensive every day, and patients who had coronary interventions. And these are the high-risk groups. These are the ones 10, 15 years down the line. We do, what is the prevalence of aneurysms? I mean, do you think it's that uncommon? It's rare under the age of 50, that is true. It is something which usually comes on after the age of 50, and that's what it is. It's more common in men than in women. And the risk factors are the same, as I said, diabetes, cholesterol, age, high blood pressure, tobacco abuse, and family history. So these are the same risk factors that there are. And 10 years after a coronary intervention, there's a 10% risk of aortic aneurysms developing, and this is the largest group, and it is increasing every day, as you can realize, because the number of coronary interventions is huge. So this is the prevalence of aortic aneurysm, and now this is something that I would like to know. So this is the aortic aneurysm. This is a spiral CT angiogram, and you can actually see it's rotating at the moment. Why it's seen here but not there. A spiral CT angiogram, and that is the infraredial aortic aneurysm. Those are the two renal arteries, and this is the aneurysm. Now, how do we actually...
Can you keep the mic?
Yeah, okay. Okay. So, how...
Yeah, it's moving, sir.
Sorry? Yeah, it's moving now. That's right. So, that is the aortic aneurysm that you can see, this huge one. And those are the two kidney arteries, those are the two renal arteries, and these are the two iliac arteries. And this is something which is likely to rupture, and this is something that really needs to be a plastic tube graft. And that is how a surgical bypass had to be done. A huge operation. Required a lot of, had a lot of blood loss, and of course had its fair share of morbidity and mortality. Today, none of that is what we do. Two small puncture holes or two small little cuts in the groin. And we introduce this covered stent that I talked about. It's a bifurcated covered stent. And here you can see, this is an angiogram which is being done. These are the two kidney arteries. This is the loaded graft which is on a catheter. And here you can see, we have opened up this graft. And you can see, can you see these springs? So this has been opened inside the aneurysm. And this will allow the blood to go through. And here you can see that is the aneurysm. I mean, that is the top end of the crystalline graft. It comes down to here. It divides into two. One goes down one leg, and the other one goes down the other leg. So this is something that can be placed. Of course, there is a technique to it. Unfortunately, that video is not going. I had a cartoon video which would have been very, very interesting if it had played. Unfortunately, it's playing here, but not on the screen. But so this is something that we can do without an operation. Two small cuts, introduce the aneurysm, stent graft, and actually cover this aneurysm so that eventually an aneurysm is covered. So this was the aneurysm. Now you can see that the blood is only flowing through these metal tubes, these covered stents, and that is how the aneurysm now is totally excluded. This is something can be done without a major operation. This is something that can actually be done without major risk to life and blood loss. So this is something that we can do. This is for the abdomen. We can also do similar things for the thoracic aorta. So this, what I showed you, was for the renal aorta, infrarenal aorta, but it can also be done for the thoracic aorta. Now, there is a condition that you may have heard of, which is aortic dissection. It is usually because of sudden uncontrolled hypertension in a young adult smoker male. 25, 28 year olds, unknown hypertensives, go to play a game of golf or go to play a game of tennis, and they drop dead on the field.
They dropped dead on the field. I'm sure all of you have heard about it. 25-year-old, 28-year-old, 30-year-old suddenly dying spontaneously. That is usually, and before they died, they had severe cramping pain in their chest or in their back, which ran through like a spear in through. And that is actually what was actually happening to them, was that they were having what is called an aortic dissection. That means that the the blood, while it is flowing here, it causes a rent because of the high pressure. It causes a rent in the wall of the aorta, and it splits the aortic wall into two and creates what is called a dissection between the two walls. And this is a postmortem specimen. This is the lumen, and this is the blood which is collected outside, which means in this motion. So if this increases in diameter, as you can see, this will keep reducing, and then it will get completely occluded, and it can actually, because this wall is so thin, this pressure can actually rupture it and these patients can die. So aortic dissection is an extremely dangerous condition, and it affects young, healthy males, smokers usually, and it is something which comes without a warning and comes completely straight out of the blue. This is the reason why we say high stress prone individuals in stress prone jobs, practically in all, everyone, these things, and especially if there is a family history of hypertension, these patients must be kept under surveillance. They must keep their blood pressures under control, and they must make sure that their cholesterol levels are under control, and they should stop smoking, because there is a risk of aortic dissection in these individuals because they are at very high risk of it. So it blood gets into the media of the aorta, rips the intima from within the blood vessel, and these patients can be dead on the table while it happens. Now this is a CT angiogram. You can see the aorta from here, and you see two layers here, one and another one. So the white layer is the one through which the blood is actually running, and the one outside is the false lumen of the aorta. So the blood has actually caused a false lumen all the way down up till here, and you can actually see it even go down into this leg. So this is something which has happened. There is a cut here, there is a rent here, and this has actually ripped the walls of the aorta. So this is an aortic dissection, and this is something what it is. And this patient, fortunately, I mean, he came with a very high blood pressure, but he came to us within time. We got him down, lowered his blood pressure, kept him in the ICU, lowered his blood pressure, and then immediately took him to fix this rent, this defect that was there. And here you can see we got a catheter from below, and here is the catheter, and here now, I don't know whether you can appreciate, can you hear this? Can you see this jet of blood which is then causing this hematoma outside the lumen, and this is compressing the true lumen. So this is the true lumen, and outside what you see is the false lumen. And here then finally we have placed that aortic stent graft, and you can you see the mesh here? You can see the mesh outside, and this has actually repaired, I mean this has actually prevented the blood from flowing out from here into this, and now the aorta is completely secure and the blood is actually flowing through the stent graft. So this is something, if it can be picked up at the right time, this can actually prevent death in a lot of these individuals. So this is something that can be done, and this is what is called a TVAR or a thoracic aneurysm, endovascular aneurysm repair, TVAR, and this is for type B dissections for patients who have actually dissected their aortas. If they develop an aneurysm, sometimes you develop an aneurysm of the thoracic aorta, as you can see here, this patient actually came to us with hoarseness of voice. A lot of times these patients develop hoarseness of voice for no reason. You go to an ENT surgeon and you know, there's nothing wrong. It's just a vocal cord paralysis. Why is there a vocal cord paralysis? You get a CT scan and you spot that there is a thoracic aortic aneurysm. The thoracic aortic aneurysm on the left side presses on the left recurrent laryngeal nerve, which loops under the arch of the aorta. If you remember your anatomy, the recurrent laryngeal nerve loops under the arch of the aorta, and this is what, if it is compressed there because of an aneurysm, can actually cause hoarseness of voice, and that is what is the symptom that these patients come to us for. That is the aneurysm, and here you can see that we have placed this
stent graft within and the aneurysm is now covered. So the blood is now actually flowing through the stent graft and the aneurysm is covered. So this is done as for a thoracic aneurysm repair. And this is, of course, most of these times, these stent grafts are placed through small cuts in the groin. We are getting even more aggressive. The technology is actually even improving even more than we ever envisaged. And now we can actually do these procedures through a puncture hole. No cuts in the groin, a simple puncture hole. We have what are called sealing or ProGlide sutures. These are special suturing devices which can be placed prior to putting in the catheter, and then once the procedure is done, you can close them with the purse string and the whole thing closes and there is no cut. There is not even a cut. The patient can actually, and if it is done under local anesthesia, which we do most of the time, the patient can actually get up and walk home on the same day. Because this is patient came to us with an aneurysm. This was a seatbelt injury again. This was a guy who came to us with a seatbelt injury, and here you can see he's a 19-year-old male, Amritpal, 19-year-old male, seatbelt injury, and that was a covered stent that was placed just to cover that area and reinforce that area so that that thing does not increase and rupture at some stage. So this is something that can be done. So aortic aneurysms, as we can see, things we need to look out for, especially in the high-risk groups. It is something that happens and can be treated without an open operation, which is what used to be done before, with endovascular means, provided it is picked up at the right time and diagnosed, and it can be done at the right time. So now, how do we pick up these patients? How do we know that these patients are prone to develop aortic aneurysms or peripheral vascular disease for that matter? Is there something that we can do, something that we can check for all of us, including all of us? I mean, some of us are turning 60 or more, and this is something that can be done ourselves. So we need to do what is called a vascular health assessment, a very simple tool, an ultrasound examination. There are three arteries in our body, which are actually major arteries in our body, which are accessible to ultrasound examination. Three arteries. Carotid, femoral artery, it's right under the skin, and the third is the aortic bifurcation. The aortic bifurcation, if you can actually see it and image it from below, you can actually pick up the aortic bifurcation fairly easily. So these are three bifurcations. Now again, from your anatomy and your pathology, if you remember, when the blood flow continues in a straight line, it continues to flow. Whenever an artery divides, it forms a fork when there is a division. So the blood which is coming from below, it hits that cause an intimate injury. So if you want to look at atherosclerosis or development of atherosclerosis, look for bifurcations. Which are the three bifurcations that we think of? Carotid bifurcation, aortic bifurcation, and femoral bifurcation. So if there was a way to pick up these arteries and ultrasound image them and identify if there are plaques out there, or do either for the carotid arteries, as you can see, holding a scanner probe, you can actually pick up the carotid artery and you can actually measure any plaque or any this thing which is there, and this can actually show us and pick up what is called the intima media thickness can be measured, and this will also give us an idea as to the level or degree of atherosclerosis in a patient's body. So this is again a measure of how long a patient is going to continue to live. Longevity can sometimes, I mean obviously, you know, you can't be absolutely precise and pinpoint, but you can predict longevity. If suppose you do a Doppler scan for someone and you see a huge intima media thickness, that means the intima is almost 2.5 to 3 times the normal size, that you know that this patient is developing very galloping atherosclerotic change, and obviously he's going to run into complications. So this is something that can be done by using an ultrasound Doppler. So using an ultrasound Doppler, we can spread and identify all these atherosclerotic changes. You can use it to develop your access. You can ultrasound Doppler can be done for surveillance. You can actually keep checking these arteries again and again. There's no radiation, there's no cost of doing an ultrasound. Once you have the machine, it's very easy to do. And of course, it can tell you what is going to happen or whether the artery is getting blocked or not. And it is repeatable. You can keep repeating it every day. You can do it 5 times a day. There's no radiation either. And it can be, and it's economical because, as I said, there is no cost to doing ultrasound examinations across, except the cost of the person who's actually doing it, because there is no consumable cost in doing ultrasound doctor examination. So what is it that we are going to study? We are going to study and look at the three bifurcations and identify bifurcation disease. So we are going to look at the carotid bifurcation if there is a plaque here. We are going to look at the aortic bifurcation if there is a plaque or a narrowing there, or an aneurysm which is developing, or the femoral artery if there is a plaque which is developing or a narrowing which is developing. So if you study these three, aortic and carotid and femoral bifurcations, you can get a very good idea of the state of arterial atherosclerosis in these patients. And this can be used to identify, to calculate a vascular health score, especially in patients with diabetes, smokers, hypertensives, and dyslipidemia. So that if there are patients who have more than 50% narrowings in the carotid or in the femoral arteries, or in the femoral arteries, these patients are actually going to be running into trouble. So this is something that you can actually do to assess a vascular score. So show you, which can actually change the management that we have been. Acute deep vein thrombosis has always been warfarin and acetron. Warfarin and acetron has always been given. But unfortunately, there are numerous food and drug interactions. It has limitations which makes it difficult to practice. You have to keep checking the INRs and the APTTs and INRs all the time, and there is a very unpredictable response. And also the patients, once you start the acetron or the warfarin, it takes them a hell of a long time, 3 to 5 days, for them to develop the INR and then to stay there. So this is something which can be obviated by the use of what are called newer oral anticoagulants or novel oral anticoagulants, and there are about 3 of them which are in the market as of today. One is rivaroxaban, the other is dabigatran, and the third is apixaban. So these are 3 oral anticoagulants, newer oral anticoagulants, which are orally given. They are very efficacious, they are safe, they have favorable pharmacokinetics, and they have hardly any dietary and drug interactions, and they can be used straight away as soon as a patient requires anticoagulation. There is no lag time with any of these patients. So this was actually, we did a study of this which was published in the Journal of Association of Physicians of India, and this was published as a consensus document which recommended the use of oral anticoagulants from Indian experts. I was actually one of the working group leaders, and that is why this was published, was published in the JAPI, which is why the current practice, which is, as we say, we use low molecular weight heparin and use heparin, acetron or warfarin, it is now can be replaced by using dabigatran 150 milligrams twice a day, or rivaroxaban 15 milligrams twice a day for 3 weeks, followed by 20 milligrams subsequently, or apixaban, which can be given 5 to 10 milligrams twice a day, and this can be continued to be used as acute for deep vein thrombosis. And this actually allows us to use these drugs, which, as I said, very, very few interactions, hardly any. But of course, you have to be cautious when using these neural anticoagulants if these patients are on anti-tubercular treatment, anti-epileptic treatment, anti-viral treatments, anti-fungal treatments. So if these four indications, if these four drugs are not being used, most of these patients have no interactions with novel oral anticoagulants. So this is essentially.
Thank you.
So this is essentially what I have to say. I'm sorry, we just rushed this and it's gone extremely over time. But thank you very much for a patient hearing. And if there's any.
Post mortem.
He can't hear you.
Arterial disease prevention should be at the foremost. See, controlling lipids, controlling your diabetes, controlling your hypertension. Age itself is a risk factor for peripheral vascular disease. And sir, statins have been linked to improved prognosis in vasculopathies, including renovascular and cardiovascular, not to forget about the peripheral arterial disease, because this is the common etiology. So you need to give statins, high dose statins in all patients who have peripheral arterial disease. Sir, your comments on that?
And treat them. So if there's diabetes, an endocrinologist or a diabetologist or a physician who's looking after these patients is going to be the one who's going to be controlling them. And along with that, the treatment which of the other conditions, which is statin therapy, controlling blood pressure, controlling uric acid, and controlling homocysteine levels also, these can be, of course, you know, all as part of the adjunctive treatment. As far as statin is concerned, you're absolutely right. High dose statins are all recommended, whether it is coronary artery disease or peripheral vascular disease, especially at the time of interventions. We load these patients with about 40 milligrams of atorvastatin, and then these procedures are done. You can even go up to 60 to 80 milligrams of atorvastatin. Sometimes these patients, because of their myopathy which they have, they do not tolerate very, very high doses. But our usual practice is 20 to 40 milligrams of atorvastatin for almost all these patients.
Right. So many people live with a latent PVD. See, it is only the acute limb ischemia which becomes an emergency. Sir.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. This, see,
and what would be the typical presentation of an acute limb ischemia?
Yeah. See, atherosclerosis, as you know, is a progressive disease. It starts off with narrowing, and these patients come to you with what, as Dr. Poddar said, claudication. These patients would find it difficult to walk. They start walking, they're fine when they're sitting down, there's no problem whatsoever. They start walking, and after maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes of walking, they suddenly start having cramps or cramping pain in their muscles. It's not a joint pain, it is a muscular pain which comes on walking, and the minute they stop walking, the pain disappears. The pain disappears, the patient can walk exactly that same distance again, and then he has to stop again. So it's a walking stop, kind of exercise routine that these patients follow. They sometimes actually get around it, and that's what they do. They walk around a park, they know that it's going to hurt, so they go and sit on a bench before it starts to hurt, then they start walking again. So they're continuing to walk, but the walking distance goes on reducing as the blockage keeps on increasing. Because as you very rightly said, chronic limb ischemia or chronic atherosclerosis is a progressive disease. It is something which goes on. What happens when it acutely? One most important thing which we all miss, it's loss of temperature. When a foot or a finger or a toe or any part of the body becomes cold. See, if the whole body is cold, that's different, you're dead. You know, that's not what we're talking about, it's hypothermia. But if suppose one leg becomes cold, there is no other diagnosis other than vascular insufficiency or acute limb ischemia. That means the blood supply in that one leg is actually occluded. And every effort with using a Doppler examination, something must be done to identify this. The one thing not to do, which a lot of patients actually end up doing, pair thanda ho gaya, garam pani ki botal se garam kar lo pair. You know, heat up the leg. That's the worst thing you can do, because if you're going to use any hot temperatures, then you'll form a blister, and that's going to be a wound which will not heal, because as it is, it's a ischemic limb, and if you cause a wound there, that wound is not going to heal. So most importantly is the reduction in temperature. Then there is reduction in movement. The patient may not be able to move his toes, may not be able to move his ankles or his calf muscles and things. So that is the other thing. And of course there is pain, which can be excruciating pain. The pain can be completely out of bounds for this, for the clinical examination. You are not able to feel anything, there's nothing there, but the patient is having intense pain, and that pain in a cold limb which is not moving is probably diagnostic of acute limb ischemia.
So to refresh, acute limb pain with cold distal extremities, with absent peripheral pulsations, and brachial ankle index of less than 50 millimeter mercury would be an acute limb ischemia.
That's right. You know, if you remember our Bailey and Love, general surgery.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, five P's. P for Punjab.
Yes.
P. Pale, pallor, pain, pulselessness, and paresthesia. These were the five P's for acute limb ischemia. So this is something that is there, and
And if a person has this, this is probably diagnostic of acute limb ischemia.
They didn't talk about the ankle blood pressure.
No, those were the symptoms. The five P's are the symptoms that the patient comes to you. Ankle brachial index is a blood pressure measurement of the ankle,
yes.
And the brachial artery. And if usually they should be the same, the blood pressure of the arm and that of the ankle should be the same. Maybe the leg, the ankle pressure should be higher than the ankle, the brachial pressure. But if the ankle pressure is lower than that of the brachial, that means there is less blood going down to the leg. And if it is less than 50%, it is cause for great concern, as you very rightly
said. Unless you have a subclavian probably artery disease as well.
Well, if then that is low as well.
Thank you, sir.
Cardiac core. They have over the 10 years period, 10% chance.
Yes.
Of having an aneurysm.
That's right.
So, we don't forget, because they are also having diabetes most of the time, hypertension, dyslipidemia also, and atherosclerosis. So, it may not be part purely due to the procedure. Procedure may be, maybe just a point to be added.
Yeah, it's not because of the procedure. I mean, the cerebral vascular atherosclerosis or peripheral vascular atherosclerosis.
Just giving the statistics.
Yeah, my last question and one more comment I will give. One of my patients, known to me, has a deep vein thrombosis treated by you at Gangaram, still coming to Medanta, still not well. What can be done?
See, it all depends on where exactly the thrombosis is, whether it is affecting the inferior vena cava or the iliac veins or in the peripheral veins in the legs. So if we can identify where exactly the narrowing blockage is, if it is in the iliac veins, and so much time has elapsed that the patient is still having symptoms, we can actually do angioplasty of the veins. We can actually open up these veins, increase the flow. Because you see, the symptoms are because of blockage and because of the congestion of blood in the legs and the swelling which occurs. So if you can do an angioplasty of the iliac veins, that can increase the flow and reduce the swelling and reduce the symptoms in the legs.
My comment to the frequent, say, seat belt injury involving to the aorta. What I do personally, I wear a cushion.
Yes.
In between the belt and my chest.
That's right. Some of the newer SUVs, the bigger, you know, the companies, they actually come to you with padded seat belts today. They're completely padded and insulated, which is basically to avoid seat belt injuries. You're absolutely right. That's right.
Sir, deep
artery and
peripheral
artery,
the thrombosis.
Peripheral arterial thrombosis को peripheral arterial disease को अगर treat नहीं करेंगे तो artery आपकी अगर बंद हो जाएगी, पैरों में gangrene हो जाएगी, gangrene होगी तो amputation करना पड़ेगा।
लेकिन तो patient को है ना coagulation में improvement हो रहा है, अलग वापस taking का है ना antiplatelet
and statins, see आप जब ये blockage होता है तो अगर हम पेशेंट को कहते हैं कि आप कीप वॉकिंग, अगर वो चलता रहेगा और आगे एंटीप्लेटलेट्स एंड स्टैटिंस और ये सब कुछ लेंगे, सो कोलैटरल्स बनते जाते हैं। व्हेन यू वॉक मोर यू डेवलप मोर कोलैटरल्स, सो दिस कैन समटाइम्स रिलीव द सिम्टम्स, बट इफ द आर्टरी कीप्स गेटिंग ब्लॉक्ड ओवर आई मीन यू नो ओवर अ प्रोलॉन्ग पीरियड ऑफ टाइम एंड ओवर अ यू नो अ ग्रेट डिस्टेंस और अ ग्रेट लेंथ ऑफ आर्टरी गेट्स ब्लॉक्ड, देन दीज पेशेंट्स कैन इवेंचुअली, इफ एनी ऑफ द मेजर कोलैटरल्स गेट ब्लॉक्ड, then they can get into trouble, and then these patients will, you will not be able to salvage them because there are no main arteries left, everything has got blocked. So it's better to pick them up early and treat them so that the avoidance, you know, so that you avoid an amputation.
Any role of anti-gelatin?
Lot of work has been done, was done.
Pressure points.
See, it's not proven the test of time. Anti-gelating agents have been used before, but they really are not consistent with their results. This is not something which is, and they can have a huge complications because they can cause renal damage. You know, a lot of these can cause renal damage. So, aap pair ki artery bachane gaye, pata laga uski kidney band ho gayi. You know, so you can develop renal shutdown also with those agents. And as it is, as I said, the effects and the outcomes are not quantifiable and they are not absolutely certain. So it is not something which is routinely used for most patients.
Pressure valve?
pressure wala to again basically what you are doing is you are increasing the sympathetic return. You know, whenever जब आप peripheral pressure बढ़ाते हैं तो आपका sympathetic dilatation हो जाता है, that causes vasomotor relaxation and some amount of blood flow increases in the area. So it's a symptomatic improvement, but artery नहीं खुलती.
When we were doing our MBBS, we heard of a disease called Berger's disease, and it was related with smoking. It is also a peripheral arterial disease.
Yes.
How is this disease different from the diffuse vascular disease caused by diabetes?
Okay. Differentiation is Berger's does not happen over the age of 40 years of age. So it is for a young adult smoker male. That's by definition Berger's. So if you have a 50, 60, 70 year old male, it's never Berger's. It is always peripheral atherosclerosis. So if you have a patient who is under 40, who's been a smoker, who has developed gangrene and has, and usually unfortunately is seen from the lower socioeconomic strata, these patients still continue to suffer from Berger's disease. But as the affluence spreads and as the patients start smoking and drinking and eating a lot of other things, peripheral atherosclerosis is what takes over, and Berger's disease in our country also, unless you go into the periphery, unless you go into the lower socioeconomic strata, is extremely uncommon, or not extremely, but is getting relatively uncommon. It is practically unknown in the Western civilization. Nobody in America or in England or in Germany, France develops Berger's disease because of the high socioeconomic strata. But in our country, because of the smoking, and it is supposed to be, as they say, there was a lot of study about it being being tubercular in origin. It was an allergy to the tubercular protein which caused Berger's disease. That was also one of the theories, never proven. But otherwise, it is essentially a result of a hypersensitivity reaction to the tobacco, which causes an inflammation of the arteries, and all the arteries get completely blocked out. And this is where stem cell therapy is what is used. You can't really help these patients with angioplasty and balloons because those arteries are completely cicatrized. They are fibrosed, so you can't really open up these arteries. But we are doing a lot of work on them with using stem cells harvested from the same patient, and this is something that is possible for Berger's disease.
Berger's, usually there will be no atherosclerosis of the major vessels.
Berger's disease also, I think that's a very important, I'm glad he brought that up. Berger's disease affects the small and medium sized arteries. It does not affect the aorta or the carotids or the main femoral arteries. It is usually the small and femoral arteries, and that is why you get what are called corkscrew collaterals, but the main arteries are remaining.
Sir, so my last question. Sir, you talked about the NOACs, and I'm sure that there must be a great role for these newer agents. You must be using them very frequently. How often do you encounter the bleeding complications? Because these patients are not only on NOACs, they must be on antiplatelets as well. So how frequently do you encounter bleeding complications, let's say intracranial or peripheral or GI bleeds? How common is that side effect?
Okay, so comparing the NOACs with warfarin and acetrom, the safety is practically the same. Maybe that the safety of NOACs is higher safety as compared to warfarin. In fact, the risk of intracranial hemorrhage is higher with warfarin as compared to one of the NOACs. Okay, so it is relatively safer. So that is number one. In my practice, actually, all these three that we talked about, dabigatran, rivaroxaban, as well as apixaban, we were international study centers. I was actually the international lead for these studies, drug trials, when they were done in India. And I have been actually using them now for the last almost 15 years. You know, they've been in the market only for the last 5 years or so, but they've been because we were using them in the trial. And believe me, we've very rarely seen patients with massive bleeds, life-threatening bleeds or other bleeds with these patients. So bleeding complications are relatively low. Having said that, today there are specific antidotes which are available, which can be given, which can work within 15 minutes of giving them and they can actually completely neutralize the effect of dabigatran. Dabigatran is one anti, oral antibiotic, and the newer and the antidote available is called praxpine.
But very costly, sir.
Yes, but there is another. I can give you another this thing on it. I mean, a writer on this. If the company has actually, we've actually managed to do this with them. We impressed upon the company and said that you know that this patients bleed very rarely from this. So the need for this praxpine or this very expensive, it's over 1.5 lakhs for one ampule. For the need for this is going to be relatively low. So what can we do to help these patients? So dabigatran, if a patient is on dabigatran from the original research molecule and he is registered with the company, no cost. If, God forbid, he bleeds, praxpine or the antidote is given to them by the company free of cost.
Great, sir.
So that is something that can be done.
Thank you for the lift that you always give him. And to Dr. Rajiv Parekh, my senior from Rana.
Sir.